officer, staff, and some of the trainees of skill development program, and my dear students. Today is the last day of this year as per our calendar. Today is 31st December, and we are eagerly waiting for the next year to begin. So on this occasion, I would like to wish you all Happy New Year in advance. Thank you. And today, being the last day, we wanted to conclude the year by holding third Krishi Gyan Deep, you know, knowledge series lecture by Dr. Sukhpal Singh. In fact, I recall 27th and 28th February year 2000. So that was the day I was holding one national seminar on private extension in National Institute of Agriculture Extension Management, you know, manage. I just joined manage, and I was holding that first national seminar, and contract farming was, you know, emerging in Indian agriculture scenario. So we thought of inviting one prominent speaker to handle that session, and only one name came to our mind, Dr. Sukhpal Singh. So we invited Dr. Sukhpal Singh, and very good gathering, and it was a huge success. And recently, when we were discussing about again contract farming after 18 years, again we wanted to, you know, call someone, and again Dr. Sukhpal Singh came to our mind. So I mean to say, Dr. Sukhpal Singh is one professional, you know, who has been working in this particular field, you know, contract farming, from the past, you know, two decades, and he is an authority. He is on, you know, various committees promoting this concept. And we are very happy to have you here today. And before, you know, requesting Dr. Sukhpal Singh to give a talk, I would like to give a brief introduction of the speaker. Dr. Sukhpal Singh is a professor and former chairperson, Center for Management in Agriculture, CMA, Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad, Gujarat, and former Director General, Center for Research in Rural and Industrial Development, CRRID, Chandigarh. He is founding co-editor, Millennial Asia, an international journal of Asian studies, and a member of the editorial boards of many national and international journals. He has 12 books, the latest being Institutional Innovations in the Delivery of Farmer Services in India, 2018, Springer Publication, and more than 130 research papers in international national journals, edited books, and more than 90 review articles in popular dailies, magazines. To his credit, he has been recently conferred the title of Fellow of Indian Society of Agriculture Economics for his contributions to the discipline and the society. He is on the boards of many non-profit working making organizations in agriculture and rural space. He was a visiting fellow at the IDSSX, Chulalongkorn University, Bangkok, and University of Manchester, and the Copenhagen Business School, and a member of various committees, working groups of Planning Commission, the present Niti Aayog, the National Development Council, and Food Safety Standards Authority of India, and EC of Mission on Integrated Development of Horticulture. He is a member of the Expert Group on Agriculture and Allied Activities of Niti Aayog, Standing Working Group on Agriculture and Allied Sectors of Chhattisgarh State Planning Commission, and the Committee of Farmers Producers Organization Policy for Punjab, and Committee on Minimum Support Price and Other Mechanisms for the Farmers in Chhattisgarh. He has provided research support to international agencies like ADB, FAO, ILO, ICCO, IFAD, International Trade Center of the United Nations, Tradecraft, and the World Bank. And we are privileged to have you here today to give the third Krishi Gyan Deep Knowledge Series lecture. So welcome you again, and I request you to deliver the talk. Thank you very much.
Drashekra, Director General of CCS NIAM, participants of the Agri Business program, participants from other skill building programs present here, members of the faculty and many friends among them. And let me say it's a pleasure to be here at NIAM once again after 2 years to do this duty of delivering a talk on a topic which I know a little bit about. So what I plan to do, keeping in mind the larger purpose of this series lecture, is to dwell on the topic in terms of concept of contract farming, then the practice of it, how it is coming up in India and in other developing countries, what are the issues which we need to look at as professionals, as academics, as policymakers, what are the policy issues, and what do we make of this mechanism of coordinating production and markets for farmers, that too in a context where the vast majority of the farmers are marginal or small farmers. I have given some background material which will be perhaps made available to you very soon. So I would go into the talk straight away by first telling you what contract farming is not about. But a lot of misperceptions about this concept. People mix up contract farming with corporate farming. People mix up contract farming with direct purchase. People mix up contract farming with captive farming many times. And most of the time also, contract farming they mix up with cooperative procurement. It is shocking many times to see people give examples of Amul and many other such cooperatives saying they are also doing contract farming. So we should understand that these are all very different concepts and practices of engagement of various stakeholders in the agribusiness sector. Corporate farming, just to set the record straight before we sort of get into the concept of and discussion on the issues of contract farming. Corporate farming is about owning land or leasing in land to do farm production, which, if I may just brush it aside by saying that as of now in India, it's not permitted because we have ceilings on land holdings acts at the state level, under which no non-agriculturist can own land. Therefore, corporate farming by law is illegal in India as I stand and speak to you today. Therefore, you would not come across any legal cases of corporate farming by anybody on their own land if they are not farmers. Captive farming is a variant of corporate farming, that you have that land, the production on that land being used for your own processing and other requirements, not to be sold to others. So neither captive nor corporate farming has any space in India today. Then we come to the other confusing aspect, which was direct purchase. As all of you know, since 2003, three new mechanisms of procurement were made legal in India with the amendment of the Agriculture Produce Market Committee Acts at the state level, starting with the Model Act by the Union Ministry of Agriculture at that time, which was direct purchase, contract farming, and private wholesale markets. So when we say that these are three different channels, so the two channels cannot be same by concept and by law. So direct purchase has nothing to do with the concept of contract farming. You procure from farmers or purchase from farmers whenever you need, without any commitment to buy or without any commitment to sell from the farmer's side. And last thing I want to clarify is about cooperatives being cited as cases of contract farming. When we say contract, whether farming or otherwise, any contract has to have two legal separate entities to engage into a business transaction. And we know that cooperatives are owned by farmers who may be suppliers of milk or other commodities, their own cooperative. There's no separation of ownership between the farmer and the cooperative there. So cooperatives cannot be cases of contract farming wherever they procure, because they are farmer-owned entities. We are not talking about two different legal entities to engage in a transaction which can be called contract farming. So I argue that cooperatives, to be more successful and viable in a competitive market scenario, should also resort to some semblance of contract farming. Yeah, to manage the supply chain issues better, to manage markets better, they should also get into relations which are more contract farming, like with their own members, if they want to survive and grow in a competitive market scenario. So that was what we will not talk about. Whatever I talked so far, various concepts, we will not get back to them because they are not the topic of the day today for us to deal with. So when we say contract farming, basically we are talking about the two parties, the buying side, it could be a processor, exporter, or retailer who need agricultural produce, whether raw materials or semi-processed or processed, to make a business out of it. And on the other side, you have farmer who is looking for a good market for his or her produce. So when these two parties, for reasons of improving their own well-being in terms of making their business work better, engage with each other, where the farmer, as being the producer of the raw material or the agricultural or other types of primary commodities, agrees to produce for a known buyer certain quantity or acreage of a certain variety or type of produce in a given time frame to be delivered at a given place and given time. That is what contract farming is all about. And the other side, the buyer agrees to do all that which is required to make this contract arrangement happen. It could be a simple contract where you don't provide any support to the farmer, you only agree to buy whatever you require with pre-specified conditions or terms of the agreement. That is called simple procurement contract under contract farming. That your involvement with the farmer is only to give him or her a pre-assured market. If the farmer is able to produce what you need, and a pre-agreed price, and whether you would go to the farm and pick up, or farmer will have to deliver to your factory or collection center at a given point of time which is agreed. You could also engage as an agri business firm, as a processor, as an exporter. You could engage further as a retailer, supermarket, food retailer. You could also engage further, saying that if I want the farmer to grow something which is not available in the market, then I'd also provide certain other support. Supply of inputs, seeds, fertilizers, pesticides, plant protection products, and so on. Extension, credit if farmer needs that, or anything else which helps the farmer to produce better for you, then that is called resource provision contract arrangement, or contracts which have resource provision as an element, important element in them. The third is where you think the farmer would not be able to do anything on her own, so you would rather have to take complete care of the farm through the farmer. For example, you're talking about global gap certified produce which you need to export, or you're talking about organic produce or fair traded produce or responsible produce or ethically produced products. then you take charge of all the farming decisions, and farmer or primary producer only implements those decisions for you on his farm with self-labor, family labor or hired labor, but you give all the directions. That is called total management contract. The highest level of involvement of a company in the farmer's affairs, of course with mutual agreement. Yeah, so all this we are saying is in order to ensure better performance on the two sides of the chain, as suppliers who are farmers and as buyers who are on the front end, as processors, exporters or food supermarket players. The important element to appreciate here is there are a lot of sort of arguments about whether contract farming is desirable to promote as a channel or not in a country like India, because it's a developing country. Preponderance of small and marginal farmers, therefore people are worried about their well-being. So people say that this could actually be an indirect way of exploiting the farmers. In fact, I even recommended an article to be published which talks about contract farming as a disguised land grab in India. The case study, very interesting case study. But those are all extensions of the argument beyond what concept aims at. One, we are saying that there is no compulsion in a contract arrangement for any of the parties to engage into it. Only if you find business sense as a farmer in working with somebody who wants to work with you for you to produce something for him or her, if you find value in that, then only you say yes. Otherwise, nobody can force you into a contract arrangement. It's a different matter that be other compulsions in the environment in which farmers work, which may lead them to start working as contract farmers, and sometimes they may realize it too late that perhaps they should not continue in that arrangement, which happens after long time of working under such arrangement. So one is not negating all that which can happen when contract farming is practiced in a given context, but the concept per se is not problematic. I generally say that it's not contract farming which is problematic as a concept or a mechanism of agribusiness development. It is how it is practiced, who undertakes contract farming, with whom, how, under what terms and conditions, and why. So those questions decide whether contract farming will be a win-win mechanism, win-lose mechanism, or even lose-lose mechanism for both the parties. And you would see a lot of literature around in textbooks and research books which talks about what are the preconditions for successful running and implementation of the contract farming programs. Yeah, one really cannot give a blueprint for success in contract farming because the situations differ across crops, regions, and the kind of arrangements you have. People talk about, I also have a plan to talk about various models of contract farming. So don't expect a blueprint of a contract farming model which can work. Yeah, one can only give you some elements of contract farming which are more desirable, and if policy and practice can promote that, then you have better chances of a win-win situation than otherwise. So even when we are talking about the model contract farming and services 2018 today, given by the ministry to the states, it had given a model contract farming agreement in 2003 to the states when contract farming was part of the APMC Act. But now when contract farming has been taken out of the APMC Act and made into a separate act or law, it specifies certain things and gives a model contract farming agreement. But that doesn't mean that agreement can do the job of ensuring a win-win. Because nobody can provide for all the elements, unforeseeable things which happen in a contract situation in a given context. So you can only work towards that. Recently, I was in Harare in Zimbabwe in an FAO workshop last month, in fact, November, where the FAO is now talking about responsible contract farming. Yeah, we heard of responsible production and responsible consumption as UN's development goals. Yeah, but now FAO is talking about responsible contract farming per se, saying that if you do not do it in a manner which is good for everyone, then there could be problems. So if you see on the ground, there are many, many models in place. You have bipartite model where company and farmers work directly with each other. Then you have tripartite model where the bank comes in to provide the credit to the contract farmers who otherwise may not have access to credit to do good production of a contract crop. Because let me tell you, all my 3 dozen of more studies of contract farming over the last 20 years show, not only my studies, many other studies also show, that generally it is more expensive or costlier to produce under contract farming arrangement than a non-contract situation. Because you have to produce according to specifications. You cannot compromise on certain inputs and services which a crop may need. Therefore, you end up spending more. And if you do not have that kind of money, which contracting company generally will not provide you because they are not in the business of financing you. They are the business of providing a market for you. They are the business of helping you to produce with extension, better extension and so on. But contracting company generally do not provide finance. So you get a financial institution, a bank or any other such entity to come in to provide finance to the contract farmers. And when these contract farmers supply produce to you, you pay the bank or the financing agency first, deducting from those payments which you have to make to the farmers, and the rest of the money is paid to the farmers. So it's a win-win situation for all the three parties, because the bank would not lose the money, because the contracting agency has agreed to first make the payments from the payments for the produce of the farmer to the bank, and then only later on use other money for other purposes and pay to the farmer and so on. So that is a tripartite model. The other model is what is called quadpartite or four-party model, where there are people who are better at organizing farmers for contract farming. Now every food processor, every exporter cannot be working with farmers. In fact, there are a lot of food processing companies, lot of exporters who have never been to a farm in the past. And for good reason, they also believe that it is not their cup of tea to work with thousands of small farmers or big farmers. They would rather hand over this job, outsource this job to somebody who is good at that. So we have examples of that in terms of agri extension companies, agri input companies, or other agri output companies working as facilitators of contract farming between the company, farmer, and the bank or the financial institution. So four of them come together to set up this arrangement so that you get the best possible interface with the farmer. So that is four party or quadpartite model, which is also in practice. All this I'm saying, all this has been practiced in India. It's not from other countries. It is very much the reality in India for the last 10, 15, 20 years across crops, across states, across companies. Yeah. So then you also have other extensions of that model where people say that the agri input company or agri extension company also thinks that perhaps due to reasons of high transaction costs, it cannot really go on to work with so many hundreds or thousands of farmers directly. So they appoint what is called franchisees or sub-franchisees or facilitators or agents at the district level, sub-district level, local level, who are asked to work with the farmer as per instructions of the company and paid for that to deliver that service on behalf of the organizing agri input company which organizes contract farming. So that has also happened in this country as contract farming practice. So there are models and models and models. And that tells you that there cannot be a blueprint for contract farming. If somebody says, what is the best model of contract farming for India? I think one will be at loss to answer that kind of question. And the example I give on this is that you have one company in this country which has experience across the globe, which practices five different models of contract farming for the same crop in five different parts of India. Can anyone name that company? Pepsi. For the same chip potatoes, they have one model in Punjab, another model in Maharashtra, another in Karnataka, yet another in Jharkhand, and yet another in Gujarat, and wherever other states they work with. So that is the diversity of context. But what we are highlighting here is that it is the context of the contract farming practice which we need to take note of and understand. Yeah? There are many actors and factors in the local environment which help your work or hinder your work. There are different institutional structures in different states, even at the farmer level. So unless you factor that in, you would not be able to have the appropriate model of contract farming for a given crop in a given local area. So that is about the basic understanding about contract farming when we are looking at using it as a practice. Yeah. So if I move on further now from this, because we need to also conclude this within given time frame, then I would say that the contract farming is also evolving over time in India also. If you see, earlier we only used to talk about acreage contracts right from the seed companies since 1960s, where the first ever modern contract farming happened in India, starting with National Seed Corporation and State Seed Corporation, all the private companies, for the simple reason that they could not own land to do their own seed production, which they would have liked otherwise, because Land Ceilings Act doesn't permit non-agriculturists to own agricultural land. So starting from that, contract farming, which became much more common in perishables in the 1990s and early 2000s, there is a growing understanding of the issues in the Indian context. So companies have moved from acreage contracts to quantity contracts. Earlier they would say, plant 3 acres for me of this crop in this season and I'll buy back whatever you get out of that. Now they say, no, don't plant just 3 acres. You plant 3 acres, but I expect that you'll get 5 quintals or 10 quintals of produce from each acre and give me 60 or 80% of that quantity you expect to get. So that is called quantity contracts. That ultimately company is not interested in how much area you have grown for the company, but how much company is going to get actually or can hope to get. So you want to be sure of your supplies as a buyer. So you say, okay, I give you some leeway in terms of if you want to side sell, if you want to play games with me, you can do that with 40% of the produce you get, you're expected to get, but 60% I should get. Otherwise, I'll not work with you. And if you don't give 60%, I will penalize you. Or you'll have to get from another contract farmer, and give same quantity and quality and variety to me if you want to work next year. So that is one development that over time companies have learned that just giving acreage contracts is not workable. You need to get into specifics of it to avoid farmer defaults on quantity as well as quality. Many times farmers say, no, our quality is not good, therefore I sold it outside. Simply because you got a few rupees more per quintal or per kg or whatever. The second is that farmers generally in small context, small farmer context, face issues of production risk and market risk, especially production risk. Even in India, you know that despite all the improvements in crop insurance schemes over the last few decades, including the latest Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana, the coverage is not going beyond 30-35% of the gross cropped area. So some of the contracting companies, in order to bring additional value for the farmers, has also introduced crop insurance as a component in contract farming. That you are not just going to give the farmer reduced market risk in terms of giving a definite market and assurance of purchase and assurance of certain quantity purchase which meets quality standards, but also help her or him in saving the crop produce or compensating from another agency, which is an insurance company, to some extent. So the farmer is not completely destroyed if crop fails. He is able to get some money for the crop loss as a crop insurance payment claims, and then still able to work with you next time. And third is, which I mentioned briefly earlier, that franchising elements are coming into contract farming. That given the nature of farming in countries like India, where the large number of 1 acre, 2 acre, 3 acre farmers, you really cannot achieve scale by going to more and more and more number of farmers. Transaction costs really become very heavy. Monitoring so many contracts, especially if contracts as per Indian law have to be signed with each farmer, then it's a hell lot of a job. So they resort to locals, whom you can call facilitators, intermediaries, middlemen, brokers, or whatever. So that is, you make them your partners in business. Even Pepsi uses Hundekari in Maharashtra. It's a local guy who is an aggregator of farmer produce. They rope them in to their contract farming for chip grade potato, who work with farmers on behalf of Pepsi and organize everything in terms of supplies of inputs to farmers and buyback of farmer produce for the company and so on. So it's something like franchising, because you have a partnership with the local partner, local agency, saying you do this for me and we'll work together. Different names can be given to this, but that is what is also emerging as an important mechanism to work in situations where you have no escape than working with small holders, because you don't have too many large holders. Even if you have, many of them may not be interested in working with you. They may not be interested in crops which you want to grow. For example, in South India, if you want to grow gherkins, which is very, very family labor intensive crop, large farmer would not be interested in that, because they don't want to get into issues of, first of all, their family labor doesn't work on farms. They don't want to deal too much of hard labor headache. So companies also there do not give more than half an acre or 1 acre of gherkin crop as a contract crop to farmers. Now that also reminds me of another dimension of contract farming in India, which is that if we just go beyond the business of contract farming, if we are looking at contract farming for leveraging it for agriculture development, which is inclusive and sustainable, the question that arises is, do contracting companies really work with farmers who need them the most? Or for reasons of lowering their transaction costs, they end up working with farmers who are anyway doing better and end up doing much better when they become contract growers. What I mean to say is that the evidence shows, I have one paper which just appeared day before yesterday in the Economic and Political Weekly. This research shows that most of the time, contracting companies work with medium and large farmers because they are interested in volumes of produce, not trying to be good to all the farmers, not working with as many farmers as possible, but how do I get maximum quantity of the produce I want from as few farmers as possible? That's what makes business sense for anybody. Why should I go and break my head with 10,000 farmers if I can get the same quantity of produce I'm interested in from 100 farmers? So when I gave the example of gherkins, gherkins is one of the few crops in India which is smallholder inclusive in contract farming. Otherwise, most of the mainstream crops, whether it's potato or it's mint or any other contract crop you take, generally small farmers are not part of contract farming arrangements. And that is a cause for concern that if you are promoting this mechanism for agriculture development, there are a lot of policy support coming in. In fact, one of the discomforts I have with the model Contract Farming and Services Act is that the title itself has been changed. It is titled as Contract Farming and Services, brackets, Promotion and Facilitation Act, as if regulation doesn't matter anymore. In 2003, we had contract farming regulation as part of the APMC Model Act. Now I ask this question, what has changed in last 15 years that today we don't think of protecting the farmer interest? Now if you remember, in the 2003 Model Act, it was stated in order to protect the farmer interest that whatever defaults a farmer may commit against a contracting company, the company cannot lay claims on farmers' land and assets. You cannot take away farmer's tractor, you cannot claim land, rights on his land, you cannot confiscate any other assets of the farmer. So that was done because there were a lot of misapprehensions at that time in political and public circles saying that contract farming is basically an attempt by the companies to grab farmers' lands. Yeah, you referred to land grab in the beginning of the session. So, but still, even though that misperception, of course, was completely misfounded and now perhaps it has gone away because everybody now is at least discussing contract farming instead of outrightly rejecting it. And FAO is talking about responsible contract farming. So my discomfort is, or question is, how is that today we are not talking about protecting farmer interest when we know that a farmer in this country owns only a few acres and he or she is nowhere compared to a company which may be multinational, which may be national, which may be a local supermarket. So why is that we don't want to protect the farmer against any unfair practices? So that is not a very desirable thing to forget about regulation, because farmers would need some amount of support to help them, because there have been many cases in this country of companies running away after signing contracts, companies rejecting farmer produce on completely sort of irrational grounds for other reasons other than the poor quality or poor performance on behalf of the farmer side. So we would still, I would say, need policy mechanisms and regulatory mechanisms to protect small farmers in contract farming if they become part of this channel. If small farmers are included in contract farming arrangements, then we need to really care for their concerns. And one of the ways I propose, which I have written in this paper, which has appeared in Economic and Political Weekly last Saturday, is that unfortunately the Model Act, Model Contract Farming Act, does not even mention group contracts. That in order to make contract farming attractive to companies, and in order to make it a better, safer option for farmers, that there should be a provision that all the contracts which are signed in this country with farmers should be group contracts, or the government will encourage group contracts that gives a better negotiating power to the farmers as a group, as individuals, and that lowers the transaction cost for the company, because you will sign a contract with a group, not with 1,000 individual farmers who are members of that group. So some of these things have not been really thought through, not really given enough space in the model act on contract farming. I am saying this because if you look around in the neighborhood, in Thailand, the state used contract farming for bringing about agriculture development in that country. They wrote in their national development plans for 15 years that yes, contract farming is an important mechanism. We would use it to do agricultural development, but we would only encourage group contracts because our farmers are small. Let me tell you, their farmers are not as small as Indian farmers. They are much bigger than Indian farmers, but still they are small by any standards. So not only that they encouraged only group contracts by policy, they also had a model contract farming agreement in the early 2000s. But they also said, okay, if you do contract farming of this kind, the state will provide you free extension from the Department of Agriculture Extension, and the state's Bank for Agriculture and Agricultural Cooperatives, called BAC, B-A-A-C, would provide lower cost credit to contract farmers. So this is called four sector cooperation plan in Thailand. This is how you use these modern mechanisms, business, agri-business mechanisms, to get something else, which is agricultural development, which is inclusive agricultural development for large sections of farming community. And you name any crop today in Thailand, it has been contract farmed. It is so widespread because the state looked upon contract farming as a mechanism to leverage it for agriculture development. So that is the role state has to play, that's the role development agencies has to play. You cannot just leave it to the market forces to just do it between themselves as two parties, when you know that one party is not capable of dealing with the other party, which is much bigger in terms of risk taking, in terms of negotiating ability, in terms of knowledge, in terms of what we call information asymmetry. Yeah. So that is the kind of role of policy we are looking at when we talk of using contract farming for agricultural development. Now, a couple of other things I want to highlight here before we conclude. I don't know how much time we have. Uh, 20 minutes? Okay. Then I think good enough time. So a couple of other things I want to highlight before you sort of start looking at contract farming as something which is completely non-problematic. All this what I'm saying is based on practice. Practice mostly in India, but also in other countries. One that I said that generally contract farming projects or arrangements exclude small farmers, except one or two crops, one or two situations here and there, or situations where they are parts of contracts. The second is that the companies also, for example, Nestle in India, in Moga, if you go to Punjab, you look at it, they differentiate between contract farmers and contract farmers. If you are a bigger farmer with more than 25 animals, Nestle will have a direct contract with you. But if you are a farmer with 2.5 or 3.5 cows or buffaloes, then they will not touch you. They say, okay, we will send somebody who is an agent. You supply to him, he will supply to us. So that is not a responsible contract farming, I want to say. If you're talking about responsible contract farming, even at the international level today, FAO is talking about it, then this kind of practices are not very responsible, because you are exercising a bias in whom you want to work with. And those who need you the most, you are not working with them directly. You are sending them through somebody else. The other important part is there's no doubt that when contract farming happens, it generally happens in high value crops. So it leads to a lot of employment generation on the farms, because those crops are short duration, crops are labor intensive, there's not much mechanization which has happened. So it's really very good news when somebody says that contract farming is growing in local areas for crops which are labor intensive. That means we are going to get more employment. But there are two problems in that. One, that employment may not be sustainable, because in order to tackle the problems of labor management in such high value crops where quality matters, you start looking for solutions which are in the nature of mechanization of various activities, whether sowing or weeding or harvesting or pruning of fruit trees or whatever. So that employment may not be sustainable. The other part is that whatever employment is generated, it is generated without any differentiation from what has been available locally. No contracting company monitors whether minimum wages are being paid. No contract agency actually looks at whether child labor is being used or not. No contract agency cares whether there is gender gap in wages between men and women workers doing the same work on the same contract farm. So if you're looking at the interests of labor in a contract farming situation, they are just given the go-by. And that is not a very good news. Because if you keep generating employment, which is not what ILO calls decent jobs or decent work, then that is not very good news. If you're generating more of the same kind of employment, then contract farming will not have a very good name for very long. I'm referring to closer home. If you go to Gujarat border, you go to hundreds of seed companies, including multinational seed companies, contract farming operations, where there's cross-pollination of, I've looked at least BT cotton, GM cotton. The way seeds are produced, there's a cross-pollination of male and female flowers. And you have plenty of adolescents, teenage girls and boys trucked from tribal areas of Rajasthan to North Gujarat to do this cross-pollination work. These boys and girls stay on the farms for months together. Yeah, there are all kind of issues of whether they are getting decent wages, whether they are getting decent work conditions, and so on. In the contracts, the seed companies write that child labor should not be used. And they also write, if that is used, farmer will be responsible for it. So you pass on the buck saying, I am procuring that seed, but since I am not directly employing this labor, it is not my concern. But if that seed which is being produced is being produced with child labor in a contract farm, can that be clean seed? Can that be a seed which can be promoted as fairly produced, ethically produced seed, if that seed is going to lead to crops which is called cotton? We did the study because there is a big global project called Better Cotton Initiative, run by all the global textile brands called H&M, IKEA and Nike and whatnot. They are promoting something called Better Cotton, which is a cotton produced differently, keeping in mind the sustainability concerns. And all the better principles state that all that sustainability job has to be done by the farmer. That farmer will not use too much of chemicals. Farmer will reduce water consumption in cotton crop. Farmer will try to not disturb the natural habitats of birds and animals. Farmer will produce better quality fiber. Farmer will try to provide decent jobs to workers, and so on and so forth. So all the six principles are implemented at the farmer level. Now I ask this question, that if the seed which, because better cotton also allows GM seed, BT cotton seed, it doesn't ban that. So if the better cotton which is being produced by a farmer in Bathinda in Punjab But the seed of that cotton has gone from Gujarat, from Mehsana. Can that cotton be called better cotton? You can say that seed is not our business. We are into cotton fiber. But if the inputs are not fairly produced, not produced with decent work, should we treat that value chain of that product differently or not? So there are those kind of questions. Then the other question is about sustainability. That lot of contract farming projects behave the same way on the field as any other farming activity unless they are part of a sustainable market arrangement like organic or fair or better or sustainable or whatever. So the use of, I said earlier, the cost of production of a contract farmed produce is much higher. So use a lot of chemical inputs. If I tell you how many chemicals on grapes are used, you'll be shocked. 265 different chemical pesticides are used on grapes in Maharashtra, which are produced for export and domestic markets. And all these pesticides have to be tested for residues in grapes before they are exported. So if you are doing this, if you are not looking at what is the use of water, whether water is being used efficiently or not, whether chemicals are being used only adequately or not indiscriminately, then you cannot be using contract farming to promote sustainable agriculture development. Now I say this because contract farming was attempted in Punjab to diversify agriculture. Where farmers only know how to grow wheat and paddy and little bit of cotton. They're just not into anything else at all. So these contracting companies did introduce new crops, but when we examined what is the input use practices, they were using either at the same level or higher level than the mainstream crops or crops which are being produced without contract. So then if you are not promoting any practice under contract farming arrangement which is more sustainable, then what value addition you are bringing to the sustainability? If you are talking triple bottom line today, people, planet and profits, you are not attending to the planet part of it, then you are compromising the sustainability of agriculture for everybody. Instead of win-win for everybody for long, it will be a lose-lose after some time for everybody, farmers and companies. And there are many cases globally where companies move away after there is ecological degradation of soil, water, and other resources in the local areas. But farmers can't leave. Company can move away from one state to another for undertaking contract farming, but farmers can't move away. They have to be there where they belong to. So those are the concerns. Lastly, another very important point I want to highlight from policy angle is that if you are aware, recently, Niti Aayog, a couple of years back, I have also written about it, designed a model land leasing act, even a model land leasing agreement. Now we all know that tenancy so far is banned in most of the states in India. Legally, there is very little tenancy which you will get from an SSO or other survey data. It's only 6%. It used to be 10%. But if you know informally, in different states, it can be anywhere between 15 to 50%. 50% is Punjab. That in Punjab, 50% of the land is being cultivated by those who don't own it. Yeah, and it's not sharecropping. It's all cash lease. Theka. You pay me 50,000 and take my 1 acre for next 1 year. Do whatever you want to do. So if there's such a, and there, it's not tenancy, it is what is known now in the last few decades as a new concept called reverse tenancy. It's the medium and large farmers who are leasing in lands of small and marginal farmers and using it to do contract farming with various companies. So there actually contract farming is playing a negative role, because you are leading to concentration of land, operational control of land in fewer hands, where those who are more resourceful can afford to take risk, can afford to invest in new crops, are able to use the lands of smaller farmers and make bigger and bigger money. That is promoting a lot of inequality in rural areas. So we should be mindful of this. So when Niti Aayog says open up tenancy, I agree that those who want to do farming should be allowed to do farming, but can we allow it just like that without any regulation? Yeah? If you are saying tenancy should be allowed without regulation, we can also say there should be no ceilings on land holdings. In fact, Huda committee a couple of years back recommended this, that the land ceiling limits for corporate should be 25 times that for a farmer. So one asks, what has changed in this country that today when we have 33% landless rural household, you are talking about removing land ceilings? So these are the larger questions in which you have to contextualize contract farming without just looking at it as it's a standalone arrangement. It happens in local context. So that needs to be taken care of. The other big point, I would recommend this to all of you as participants of this program, if you have interest in this sort of idea and the practice, take any contract agreement of any contracting company. Analyze it for fairness. How it protects farmer interests, how it protects company interests, how it covers farmers' risk, and how it covers companies' risk. I will award you if you can tell me that this contract is very, very fair. You will struggle to find a contract which is not one-sided. I don't want to read all that because we don't have time, but each provision you can point out as being completely one-sided. Because until recently, contract farming was not monitored. Even now, unfortunate part is the contract act, Model Contract Act is framed. It may not attend to this problem because I keep traveling to different states. And when you ask them how many companies are registered for contract farming, no state has any figures. But then you ask, you have a law, you have APMC Act, under which you are supposed to vet each contract of each contingency. They are supposed to take permission and then sign a contract with the farmer. But nobody is doing the monitoring and regulation. So you have laws and acts on paper, but nothing on the ground. Again, when you travel, you ask in Rajasthan, do they know how many companies are under contract arrangement? How many have given contract farming licenses? How many of them have shown their contracts to the state agriculture marketing board or the local APMC? And how many of these know how many farmers each one works with? So that is the gap between theory and practice, that we have so many things on paper, but when it comes to implementation, I remember a story from Gujarat when we were doing this a few years back. We wanted to look at contract farming practice in Gujarat. We asked the board, how many companies? They said, we don't know, and we don't want to know also. Everything is going fine. Why do you want to create trouble? If studying a practice is a creating trouble, you can imagine what is there behind that statement. Why do you want to create trouble by raising issues when there are no issues? Yeah. So that is the kind of policy and regulation we have in this country at the state level for some of these very important aspects of agriculture and its development. Now, I don't want to go into provisions of the Model Act, Contract Farming and Services Act. I have highlighted a few. But the other part, which is that since agriculture is a state subject in this country, and each state has its own APMC Act, it's a hell for a company which thinks of India as one country. I'm saying this because I generally say that India is like 15 different countries tied together into one, because there's so much diversity. Now you have a state like Bihar, which abolished the APMC Act in 2006. Instead of reforming it, instead of amending it, you have another state called Gujarat, which said, okay, we will permit contract farming, but it will be a tripartite agreement where APMC will be a third party to the contract agreement between company and farmers. I said, why you want, you are a regulatory body, how can you have a business interest in being a third party a contract? Said, no, we want to protect the farmer interest. But as APMC are supposed to actually exploit the farmer now, not protect. No, Gujarat APMCs are different. Yeah? And then after some time we find news in Gujarat newspaper saying APMC Act being amended to break the monopoly of the APMC. Then your third state, Haryana, we said, okay, you can do contract farming, but the price you offer to the contract farming for the crop cannot be lower than the MSP if that is applicable to that crop. Now, how can you do this kind of adverse regulation, which is completely misplaced? Why should company be asked to follow the MSP? It's an agreement between the farmer and the company. And contract farming is not only about price. I may supply good quality inputs. I may supply technology which farmer values. I may raise his yield. I may lower his cost or whatever else. Why do you dictate that I should not offer a price which is lower than MSP? So this is the problem I'm highlighting is that we don't do enough discussion and debate when we frame policies and regulations. It's done by a few people sitting in few places and they have certain perspective and they just do it that way. The latest case we have read in the newspapers is of Maharashtra. There's a lot of farmer union who said the farmer doesn't get APMC, MSP. Yeah, only 6% farmers get MSP benefit in India. So therefore, it should be made legally mandatory for any buyer from farmer to offer MSP, even private traders. And they did it. Unfortunately, Maharashtra passed this amended act saying traders will also have to pay MSP to farmers. And farmers went on strike. Within a week, they had to undo it. Now, any thinking person cannot defend this clause. When I pointed this out to the farmer union representative, they said, yeah, we committed a blunder. We should not have pushed for it. I said, what logic is there? Why this MSP is promised by the state? Why are you penalizing a private trader? He has not committed a sin that he should be jailed or fined for buying at market price, which makes business sense for him or her. So this is how our policies in agricultural markets are being framed. This is just a caution I'm exercising, saying we don't do enough thinking. We are driven by lobbies. We are driven by agendas. We are driven by ignorance, misinformation, and hurry. Simply because I was in Karnataka the other day, had a meeting with the government, and I was told that they're also going to amend the APMC Act. I said, what are you? They said, no, we have only 1 week. The session is beginning, we have to pass it there. I don't think it has been debated anywhere, discussed anywhere, but since deadline is coming, we have to do it anyway. So I think this is not the way to drive agribusiness development and help small farmer development in that kind of context. I would just conclude now by saying that there are a lot of lessons which we need to learn. One is that we should not promote contract farming as a fashion or a fad, saying that it is the solution to all problems. It is just one more channel of procurement for the companies and one more channel for the farmers to sell differently. If it makes business sense compared to APMC channel or direct purchase channel or private wholesale mandi channel or farmer consumer market yard channel. It's just one more choice, welcome choice, but cannot be solution to all the farming problems in this country. Second is that it is not suitable for all crops. It is certainly not suitable for crops for which we have MSP implemented. So you will rarely come across anybody doing wheat or paddy contract farming in this country, other than basmati rice. Because they know MSP for basmati. Contract farming is working out quite well there. Yeah? So when there is a state intervention, contract farming cannot succeed because nobody can compete against the state. Yeah, state is very large, overwhelming, and has a lot of resources used or misused or whatever. The third is that we should not focus only on price in contract farming. Yeah, I generally say that there are only three ways to help a farmer in India or anywhere in the world. Help her lower the cost of production, help her get higher yield, help her get better price for the produce she has produced. Unfortunately, we most of the time get stuck with only price. What is the price farmer? If farmer can also be made to appreciate other benefits, that there's assured market. Again and again, every season you can hope to cultivate so much and sell without facing the glut, without facing complete sort of lack of market for the produce. You can also get access to new markets through contract farming. You can also get access to high value markets like organic and others through contract farming. So if you can appreciate those benefits, then we can have much more functional contract farming or sustainable contract farming. The last point is that we should also not think that if contract farming is not becoming sustainable, how to sustain it? We don't need to sustain contract farming forever. If you appreciate theory, it's basically a response to market failure. When other channels are not able to give a good deal to farmers and companies, they look for alternatives. So if other channels of open market, of direct purchase and sale, of selling directly to retail buyers, consumers, is working fine, are efficient. Now, why we are talking about this today in policy? Because we are not able to deal with one problem in this country, which is that there is this APMC, Agriculture Produce Market Committee. Now, I'm not talking about the physical space. I'm talking about the institution where you have representatives of traders, farmers, government, cooperatives, and others. They practice, these traders in these mandis practice what is called interlocking of markets, where they lend to farmers, and for that reason, farmer has to come back and sell to them or through them. There's interlocking of credit and output market, interlocking of input and output market, interlinking of credit and labor market, and whatnot. So instead of dealing with this, what I call this belling the cat, who will bell this cat of a trader or a artia or a commission agent in mandis, who is practicing something which is completely illegal, completely informal, completely unethical. So he or she is given a license to either facilitate sale and purchase between buyer and seller, or to trade in agriculture produce. But you look around, more than half of their business comes from money lending, because institutional sources are not able to go beyond 60% of the farming's lending needs. So unless we are able to break that interlocking, you cannot make this mandi efficient. Today you have a lot of new institutions like cooperatives, self-help groups, joint liability groups, farmer producer companies, and whatnot. If you go across in states of Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, you have primary agricultural cooperative societies, which are generally known to some of us only as fertilizer distribution agencies of the government, but they are procuring for FCI. They're procuring wheat, they're procuring paddy, they're procuring many other crops. Directly, farmers are selling at the village level to these agencies, which further supply it to FCI and others. So if you have that kind of arrangements, why do you want to have the institution of commission agent going? Legally, unfortunately, the 2017 APMC Amended Act also still keeps the commission agent at the central institution in the whole mandi system. Very unfortunate. It says the payments to the farmer will be directed through the commission agent. Now, when I say this in our class at IIM Ahmedabad, that if I as a farmer sell my produce, whom should the payment go? The natural answer is, sir, to the farmer. I said, no, in some parts of India, the farmer sells the produce, the payment goes to somebody who is only an agent and a middle person. We are not able to, in one state, three state governments have come and gone over the last 18 years, and this system could not be changed. There cannot be anything more unfair than this, that the seller doesn't get his dues directly to his pocket or his bank account. This is the, I call it, political economy of agriculture markets in India. So whether contract farming or otherwise, if you don't resolve these issues of agriculture markets, most of the channels cannot operate. Earlier we kept saying that these APMCs are not letting contract farming happen. Therefore, take out contract farming from APMC domain and make a separate law. So you have a model act now. I ask this question, if this is a conflict of interest, that traders will not let contract farming happen because that produce will go away from the mandi, market fee will not be received, the commission will not be received, therefore they are not letting it happen. Then what about private wholesale markets? There's even a bigger conflict of interest because you are setting up a parallel private mandi wholesale market next to the APMC. How would they let that happen? So take out the private wholesale market mechanism also from the APMC. I call it escapism. Instead of belling the cat, you are moving away. You are just trying to find escape routes in policy. Because you have a problem of political economy of agriculture, you are not able to touch certain interests in agriculture markets who are playing havoc with the entire system. So I would end up by saying that contract farming need not sustain forever. It's a response to market failure. As long as people find value, we find that we are not able to, other channels which are efficient and effective for smallholders, we should welcome it, promote it, but don't think it should be there forever. We should try to have small farmers brought into it proactively through policy, through action, through regulation, and upgrade them to not only produce as contract growers, but also share in the value, that they should also be doing local value addition, cleaning, grading, packing, and whatnot. Some of the companies are doing it in India, but not all. We should not have too many hopes from contract farming. After it's one channel, one mechanism, good mechanism, alternative mechanism, but it can't be a solution to all of India's agricultural marketing problems. Regulation. We need regulation. It may not sound very attractive to some of you, but regulation cannot be wished away. What we need is not more regulation, but more effective regulation. Thank you very much.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
My name is
I'm from second year batch 2017-19. I have a question. You've already said that there is no central repository wherein contract farming, which is done between the private companies and the farmers, is anywhere mentioned. So in case if I want to find out in a particular state which companies have entered into contract farming with the farmers, how do I go about it? Is there any informal way of finding it out?
Yeah, that's a research question. So yes, you can. Of course, if you keep your ears and eyes open, you can go around and see which crops are being grown and which processing plants are there. Okay. You can find out. There are a lot of people around in local areas who work with the farmers, who work with these companies. So that's how you call it, in a research, you call it a snowball method. Snowball method, you keep moving from one to another, and ultimately you find somebody who will give you the entire picture, local informant or whatever. But this is what it is. And that's the unfortunate part, that
yes,
since
sir.
We have... See, I'm not asking for anything additional as a researcher. I'm saying if there's a law of the land, you have a policy, you have a regulation which demands this, that every contract will be registered, either with Mandi Board or with the marketing committee, that it will be vetted by this agency saying it's good for farmers, they know golmaal, then why can't you have record of that? If it's a law, you have to follow the law. One is not asking for charity, but even that is not being done because different states have different positions on this. Some are more friendly to companies than to farmers. Some are more friendly to farmers than to companies.
So it will differ as per the state?
Yeah, it differs from state to state. Okay, exactly. Sir. Because agriculture is a state subject. Agriculture marketing is more of a state subject. It's you have to do your own homework to find out what is where and how much. Yeah?
Thank you, sir.
Good morning, sir. I'm Shailja Talwar.
Again, second year batch, PGM AVM 2017-19. My question is, can contract farming be a solution for crop stubble burning in Punjab, and which is creating a havoc in New Delhi air pollution also?
One, you are talking about two crops where I said contract farming cannot work. As long as you have MSP, no contracting company can make a success out of wheat or paddy. Yes, it can be part of contract farming solution, because if I give you a similar example, there is a company called McCain in Gujarat, which is into French fries, potato contract farming. They say that if you want to be a contract grower with us, you will have to implement water saving technology, micro irrigation, because Gujarat, North Gujarat, where they practice this, is a dry land area. Water is scarce. So they make it mandatory as a company policy. It's not from any policy or regulatory angle. The company behaving responsibly says that I don't want tomorrow to suffer this blot of saying that you are depleted the water resources. And it's also good for the farmer to sustain water resources. So I would only sign a contract with you if you have drip or sprinkler for your potato crop when you grow it for me. So you can have, if tomorrow we don't have an MSP for wheat and paddy, I'm saying this because crop burning is happening because you have MSP for these two crops. Tomorrow you remove, there are a lot of solutions being proposed, happy cedar and this and that, those bioenergy plants and whatnot, these are all half solutions. They're only temporary solutions which cannot solve the problem. I call it postponing the problem. Today, if you know that Punjab should not be growing paddy and you are still offering MSP, this problem will continue. So you remove MSP, tomorrow there will be no paddy and no crop residue burning. Nobody burns wheat residue, it's only paddy residue which is a problematic. But still, if you are talking about hypothetical situation, yes, if there's a company which says, okay, I will not only buy your grains, I will also buy your residue and I'll find another market for it. It happened in organic in India when we are looking at this cotton. Company said, okay, we want organic cotton. But if you all know, when you do organic certification, it's not crop which is certified, it's farm which is certified. The farmer said, okay, you are going to buy organic cotton, which is one season. What about next season crop? Then companies had to come back and say, okay, we will buy that, we will find alternative markets for that. Some of them opened retail outlets to deal with the second crop from the organic certified farm. They created markets for new organic products from those crops. So that is what responsible contract farming is all about. It is possible to use contract farming to find solution to problem which don't seem very specific to the crop or the in question for the company, but are part of the larger context in which you are operating.
Sir, till now only IKEA has come on the
contract with the Punjab farmers for crop stubble purchasement.
IKEA?
Yes, sir.
For what?
Sir, for crop stubble purchasement after the harvest.
IKEA is into cotton.
Sir, IKEA.
IKEA.
IDEA.
IKEA. IKEA.
Sorry?
It's a furnishings company, sir.
I know why IKEA should be interested in this.
Sir, but they have recently given up an article that they will be purchasing the crop stubbles from Punjab farmers.
Oh, maybe they just want to use it in furniture as some raw material, but that's okay. So there are many others actually that are coming in. Other day was a project from IIT Delhi. They have designed biodegradable plates and cups from paddy straw. So there are those solutions. But my problem is that these are only partial solutions, because you can't handle 20 million tons of wheat paddy straw by these small measures here and there. And still, even by dealing with this, you're only solving part of the problem of the society, which is maybe about Delhi pollution or Punjab pollution. The paddy is not problematic only for this pollution. Paddy is also problematic for the reason that it is depleting groundwater. It is not paying for the farmer. If I tell you that all the Punjab farmers, whom you call them so-called progressive farmers, are doing this losing game of growing wheat and paddy on 80% of the gross cropped area of the state, just because each acre gives you just 5,000 rupees per acre per year or 10,000 rupees per year. Is this the farming we want farmers to do in India? Even if at 50 acres, 20 acres, can a farmer's family survive with this kind of margins? But everybody is doing it. So there are a lot of policy distortions, lot of farmer level issues. I don't treat Punjab farmers progressive anymore. Sorry to say this, but that's the reality. There are many, many better farmers in other parts of India. So those days are gone when Punjab farmers were called progressive farmers. I hope I have answered your question. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good morning, sir.
I'm Praveen Kumar, my first year. Sir, my question is, if FPO and ENAM get strengthened, do we really need contract farming in future? What is your stand? Which you support FPO, ENAM or contract?
It's not either or. We should have 1,000 flowers bloom. Why you have to say only this? That is very sort of technocratic approach. Actually, I have problem with this concept itself. What is FPO? Can you tell me? Can you define what is FPO? I hate this word. I'm sorry to say this. This is such a misused term. What is new about it? What is FPO? Tell me, please. Don't mind my language. Yeah.
Sir, as farmer producer organization...
What is it? Can you define it?
It's an aggregate of farmers who can... become
a. So is it a cooperative, is it a self-help group, is it a joint liability group, is it a producer company, is it a federation, is it a trust, is it what?
Is it trust trust between farmers?
No, trust not between, trust as a legal body. Yeah. So what is it, which one you are referring to?
It's.
I think what you are having in mind is a farmer producer companies, not FPO, which is a new concept since 2003. Yeah, FPO has been there since 1930s and 40s, since Amul time.
Yes.
So this umbrella term is very, very problematic. We mean something and say something else. So if you are saying farmer-producer companies, then that is a different kind of orientation you are talking about. But let's not talk in terms of either or. We should have contract farming. We should have farmer-producer companies negotiating with contracting companies to get better terms for farmers. As a group, if Pepsi can do contract farming with potato growers through a potato growers cooperative in Thailand, what stops Pepsi from working with farmer producer companies in India? Provided the government wants it to happen, provided the farmers want it to be rooted like this. In Gujarat, there are potato farmers who are already doing group contracts on their own. They have already resorted to group contracts. They are getting much better deals. So we need all this. We need farmer producer companies, we need contract farming, we need APMC also. Yeah? We need as many channels for the farmers to sell their produce as possible. We need to give choice to farmers. So let's not say this is in, this is out. No, that's not the way.
Thank you. Is there any companies still working on contract farming with the farmers for mint procurement? Is there any reference, sir?
Yes, these are local companies now. There used to be one big US multinational called AM and Todd, which was a big player, including working in Punjab, which we studied. And they were doing very, very innovative things in terms of promoting mint, not only as a main crop, but as a third crop and intercrop and so on, to give additional benefit to the farmer. And let me tell you, that company didn't avail of any government subsidies, didn't get any help from anywhere. Single-handedly is trying to do a lot of innovations in contract farming of mint in Punjab, UP and other area, neighboring areas. But because of the international market fluctuation, they just went bankrupt. But these are the high-value crops which cost very little for the farmer to produce. You only need to make the farmer understand that if he or she takes this little extra effort, you can make good amount of money. So these are the crops, high-value crops, the mint or its turmeric or its your gherkins or flowers or whatever, spices. There's so much. Or even I call organic also as high-value as of now. Fair trade. You will be surprised to know that in Gujarat, there are farmer-producer companies which are making their members produce fair trade groundnut, which is going into, if you have tasted this paper boat chikki, that is fair trade certified chikki being sold in Indian market, produced by Gujarat's peanut producers. So there are lot of potential in the agricultural space to use contract farming to get farmers to produce high value crop which can give them big money. For example, on this doubling farmers income, my take is that unless India moves away from growing wheat, paddy and other such low value crops on 60% of its grass cropped area, you can't double farmer incomes in 5 years, even 7 years, even 10 years. Definitely, farmer producer companies by and large in India, as they exist today, the latest number is 3,200 farmer producer companies, not FPOs. FPOs are much more than 5,000. So, in fact, in Rajasthan, it's already happening. There are farmer producer companies of tribal farmers who are doing seed contract farming for private seed companies through the farmer producer company. The farmers cultivate seed. The producer company mediates between farmers and the seed company. It's already 5, 6, 7 year old story. It is happening. It should happen more. That is the only way. That is the only way. It's not, I'm not just talking about from smallholder perspective. It also helps companies. Instead of going to 10,000 farmers, if 10 producer companies can give you that number of farmers working for you, you just have 10 agreements signed with them. Let them deal with the other part of the chain themselves, whether they sign agreement or not. You should hold the farmer producer company responsible for delivery of the produce. So it makes a win-win situation for both sides, farmers as well as contracting companies. But many times, let me also tell you, many companies are scared of this because they think that if you deal with a group or a bigger institution, they will ask you to behave. So there are cases globally where companies have destroyed cooperatives from coming up for their vested short-term business interests. So it is not that everybody appreciates this, but if you're talking about larger picture, we need to look at this kind of platforms for small farmers to deal with bigger markets, which are global markets, which are markets driven by multinationals, markets where you have exporters, processors, big supermarkets like Walmart and Tesco and so on, or Metro or others. You need to give platform to small farmers to deal with this bigger buyers better. Anything can be included under contract farming. If provision of a service, provision of buyback only, provision of whatever. So there's no need to separate services out as a contract farming activity. Globally, it is nowhere done like that. I don't know whose idea it was, but there's no need to put services separately. But we defined, in the beginning, we know what contract farming is. We know how many models are there. There are a lot of service providers who are working through these models, right? Working for contracting companies. So where is the need to bring this as a separate category in the Model Act? I fail to appreciate that.
Thank you, sir.